sunny, warm all day. Enjoy a lot of classes. How many of them we're going to have, but we're going to enjoy every one that we do have. I have another number of announcements for you in the bulletin as well as some others here. On Wednesday, November 11th, coming up this Wednesday, we're having episode 4 of our Bible study, The Chosen, the video series. Episode 4, The Rock on Which It Is Built, is the name of this episode. If you are not able to get over to Bethel at 7 o'clock on Wednesday nights, if you'd like to watch this and have not been able yet to find it online or so on, let me know. And we'll see about getting you set up so you can watch it at home as well. If you really enjoy it. The nut sales are continuing. There's still some left. Sean Marshall tells me, so see her. There's information in the bulletins. And as we mentioned before, that is the classes it reads donate the proceeds of that to the Washington for medical bills. This Tuesday evening, that's November 10th, 7 p.m., is the Pastor Parish Relations Committee meeting. So those of you on Pastor Parish will be meeting that night over at Pleasant View Church. Operation Christmas Child is going on. We have 2 more weeks till Sunday, the 22nd of November, to get the boxes in so they can be delivered on time. I do want to thank you, those of you who attended the Charge Conference after service last Sunday over at Bethel. I think it went really well. I know the money. That was really good. In future years, we'll try and do that similarly if we are allowed to have it after church on Sunday. So we'll have something else. Another meeting, which I know the hardest to do. This coming Saturday, November 14th, I mentioned this last week, but I want to mention it to you again because it's the last time we'll be meeting before that happens. The Brief Share program at St. Mark's United Methodist Church in Findlay is having a special one-time 2-hour session called Surviving the Holidays with Brief Share. Now, Brief Share is a 13-week video-based Christian program to help people who have lost a loved one, spouse, or child, or parent, or so on. But this is a separate, standalone 2-hour program from 10 o'clock till noon. It's at the dock building behind St. Mark. It's a free program. They do ask for registration. You don't make registration, that doesn't mean you can't go, but it's helpful so they know how many books to get. They do ask for a $5 donation for the book. But other than that, it is a free program. So if you have an interest or know of somebody who this would benefit, please let me know, and I'll see about getting you further information so that you can participate in that. It's from 10 to noon, next Saturday the 14th, at St. Mark's Dock Building in Findlay. Also wanted to make one correction, I believe it's in this one as well. The hanging of the greens, the hanging of the greens at 7 o'clock is going to be on Sunday, November 29th, not December 6th. This is right. Oh, no, that's no problem. We'll get it in here late the next week, but yeah, it is November 29th, not December 6th. And you want to make note, Kathy, Kathy's not here today. She had a birthday on Friday, so happy birthday to Kathy. Alicia, where's Alicia at? I saw her a little bit ago. She left! Oh! Well, she has a birthday tomorrow. So, if everybody, when she comes back in, everybody yell happy birthday to her. And Mackenzie, well, she's having one on Tuesday, so. I also want to remind you, especially for those of you who have kids watching online, the Sunday school videos are now being posted. This week was the second one. I know Shara and Alicia put that one on, and Jean and I did one a week ago, and we'll be seeing those throughout November, talking about what we're thankful for in this month of Thanksgiving. So check out those videos on our Facebook page. And I think you'll enjoy those. One other announcement that I have before I open it up to the floor, something I'm very pleased to share with you. not only is the happy birthday, Alicia, tomorrow. Your timing is very good. Not only is the parking lot done and it's beautiful, I have the privilege of telling you and to thank you because as of today, it was 100% paid for. 100% paid for. $6,650, that something like that. $610. And every dime of that, it's not that it's been pledged, it's been collected, it's been paid for. So thank you, thank you, thank you. If that, that makes it look even that much better. I appreciate your faithfulness on that. Any other announcements we need to share here this morning? We'll make note that today is communion. We put communion this Sunday since we had All Saints Day celebration or remembrance last week. The communion this month was blessed by Dan Metzger, pastor at St. Mark's, United Methodist in Finley. So since he's the elder of the church, unless the elders, I can serve him to you, he's on that license yet. They have placed in your pews with gloves and masks and all of that. So you should be very safe to spin in, and we'll do that if service goes along. So without any other announcements, I will prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Thank you. friends, to this holy day. We come to offer thanks. We come to sing and pray. So welcome, friends, to this time set apart, a time of remembrance of those we love, and a time to remember the holy promises of God. Welcome, friends, to this table of remembrance and joy, the table where we are fed, the feast we share with them. Welcome, friends, and let us worship God. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful Father, we come to you to thank you for what is good, to cry out for what is wrong, to ask for help and restoration. We come to you, O God, with aching hearts and glad souls. We gather as your beloved children. However glad we are, however out of sorts we are, we come together this day as a people whom you call into community and to a place where all are welcome. We give you thanks and worship and praise your holy name. Amen. Our opening hymn today can be found on page 528, Near My God to Thee. We are going to sing the first, third, and fifth verses. So that was he a Corey, right?
He was a Corey Rossinger.
So Regina is asking prayers for the family of Shane Schaefer, Corey Rossinger graduate, who graduated with and Regina's son Tim, who passed away in an accident this past week. Was that what you're saying,
for it?
Are there other
down to one crutch for my dog businesses. In the house, he's pretty much no crutch. But he may have carpal tunnel in his right hand. He noticed this before he left St. Vincent's about his fingers and stuff, and now he might have carpal tunnel, which is another surgery. We will know more in December.
Okay. And you say that's his left hand?
His right hand.
His right hand.
So the hand that he has to use to crutch with.
Hey, Lori Washers, offering praise to God for TJ's progress. His therapy is going well. It's down to one crutch, but may have carpal tunnel in the right hand and may require further surgery. We'll know in about a month, so we'll keep TJ and your whole family in our prayers as you determine what needs to be done with that. Any other prayers or praises we need to offer up today? I do want to share one from over at Pleasant View. Some of you know Keith and Nancy Klein. Their son Kyle has been dealing with COVID as well and is pretty sick right now. He has a high fever and a lot of fatigue. He's not hospitalized, but he's really struggling with it. So keep Kyle Klein in your prayers as well. All right, with that, let's sing our prayer hymn, Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart, verses 1 and 4, found on page 500 of your hymn. Dearest Father, we come to you today to give you praise and to worship you as creator of all. We thank you for this beautiful weather. We thank you for this beautiful church. We thank you for the wonderful people and friends that we have in this building. We have a lot of prayers and requests that we need to bring forward today. On the back of our bulletin, we have many people that we've been praying for, and you know each one. You know their situation. You know their present state. We just trust you to answer those prayers. We know that you will do what is best in each situation. We ask you to be with all of those who are dealing with this pandemic and the COVID virus. Kyle Klein. Be with all those who are in our nursing homes, assisted living facilities. ask you to be with DJ First of All's sister Melanie and her family as they grieve the passing of Melanie's husband Don after such a difficult time. Whether it was expected or not, it's always hard to say goodbye, and especially so in a time like this when I can't do it in the way that we would so want to. So give them comfort, give them peace at this time. Let them know that your loving arms are around them, supporting them and lifting them up. Also be with the family of Shane Schaefer, who was killed in an accident this week, much, much too young. Just be with his family and those who love and care for him, as it is always such a shock when things happen so suddenly. Or we ask for prayers for our nation. We've just come through this period of election, and there's still things that need to be resolved yet, but particularly, Lord, we just ask that your healing be done in this nation, that the rancor and the hatred on all sides be subsided. It can get so ugly, whether it be in social media or even in person or in print. And it must grieve your heart to see such actions. Lord, help each one of us be instruments of peace and healing and kindness in this world. Many people here in this congregation and those who may be listening online that have unspoken requests of you this morning, and we lift those up to you now. Lord, we know that you will address each one in a way that you see fit. Lord, we bring our offerings to you this morning. All that we have, we know is yours. We give a portion of it back to you as a sign of our praise and worship. We give back so little of what you give us, but we're grateful for it. And we ask that what we do give, you multiply it and you bless it and use it to the good of your kingdom and this community and here on this earth. And we especially thank you for the sacrifice of your Son Jesus Christ, who paid the penalty for the sins that we committed. He was blameless, but took upon his shoulders our punishment so that we could be washed white as snow for the shedding of his blood, that we might have an eternal life in heaven. We know that our hope is not in governments, it's not in politicians, it's not in programs, it's not in even religion. It is in the relationship we have with Christ Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And it is in the holy name of that Savior that we say the prayer he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I just noticed divine intervention. The other candle is suddenly lit. I don't know how that. Well, we must have had good connections this morning. It's time for a children's moment. Do we have anybody who wants to come up? There's room in the front row. I can stay far enough away that should be fairly safe. Since most of you are from the same family, you should be able to be together. Can you come on up here? How are you guys? And to all the kids that are watching at home, welcome. Well, this morning we're going to be talking about some scripture
two selections of scripture today. The first one is from Mark, the 8th chapter, verses 34 and 35. Then he called his disciples and the crowds to come over and listen. If any of you wants to be my follower, he told them, you must put aside your own pleasures and shoulder your cross and follow me closely. If you insist on saving your life, you will lose it. Only those who throw away their lives for my sake and for the sake of the good news will ever know what it means to really live. The second reading is from the 10th chapter of Mark, verses 17 through 22. As he was starting out on a trip, a man came running to him and knelt down and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to get to heaven?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked. "Only God is truly good, but as for your question, you know the commandments. Don't kill, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't lie, don't cheat. Respect your father and mother." "Teacher," the man replied, I've never once broken a single one of those laws." Jesus felt genuine love for this man as he looked at him. "You lack only one," he told him. "Go and sell all you have and give the money to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me." Then the man's face fell. He went sadly away, for he was very rich. This ends the reading of the scripture at this time.
Thank you, Merlin. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We are in the middle of our sermon series on the world according to Mark, that is the Gospel of Mark. In our first message in this series, we focused on the ability of a seed to grow and how it is dependent upon the type of soil that it would fall upon. And from a spiritual perspective, Jesus was trying to convey that the condition of our hearts is crucial to how well the Word of God takes root in our lives and how much fruit that it will bear. And last week, we talked about traditions and rituals and asked the question whether the traditions and rituals that we follow are more important than the God we seek to honor by following them. We are actually going to come back to that briefly at the end of our message this morning. Today, St. Mark is asking us to look at our agendas, our objectives, our motives, to see what is really important to us. You see, agendas or lists of things that we are trying to accomplish are everywhere. We have, if we attend a meeting at work, someone most likely has put together an agenda of things that need to be discussed or acted upon during that conference. If we have meetings at church or some other organization that we're involved in, there will most likely be an agenda for the meeting, whether it be written or just in the mind of the person running the meeting. Last week was a political election, in case you were unaware of it. Every political party or organization has agendas, objectives, and motives of their own that they are trying to convince people to follow. At their conventions, people or parties will put together a platform, which is a set of objectives, beliefs, etc., that they support or promote, and people will then support the party or the candidate that most closely aligns with what they believe to be important or true, or at least that's how it's supposed to happen, but that's an election for another day. The point I'm trying to make is that we all have agendas, objectives, and motives that we choose to live our lives by. Some may be good, some may not be. In today's scripture, Mark relates how Jesus is asking the man, and by extension, each of us reading this passage of scripture, to examine exactly what we are choosing to follow. Are we pursuing a personal, self-centered, worldly agenda? Or are we pursuing God's agenda for our lives? And maybe after last week, that's an important question to ask on a day like today. At this point in Mark's gospel, Jesus and his disciples have left Galilee and are heading down toward the capital of Jerusalem, where Jesus will meet his fate and fulfill his destiny. John the Baptist has recently been beheaded. Jesus' popularity and notoriety are growing quickly, and the Pharisees' disdain for him is growing as well. He's tried on a number of occasions to tell the disciples what must happen to him when they arrive in the city, but they're not able to comprehend what Jesus is telling them. They may have begun to understand who he is, but they have so much more to learn about his mission and why he has come. If you will recall a couple of months ago when we were examining lessons to be learned from broken vessels, one message focused on Simon Peter. And Jesus praised Peter for accurately stating that he believed Christ to be the long-awaited Messiah, the Son of God, and then within just a few verses immediately rebuked him because Peter objected to Jesus talking about the rejection and suffering that he would soon endure. Our first scripture reading that Merlin read this morning are the very next verses after this encounter with Peter. In Mark 8, 34 and 35, Jesus calls his disciples and the crowd around him. And it says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. And in the very next verse, he continues, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? What is Christ meaning when he tells us to deny ourselves and take up our crosses and follow him? After all, the cross of Christ is a symbol of suffering, death, shame, ridicule, rejection, and self-denial. When we as believers take up our cross and follow Christ, we deny our own selves and commit ourselves to three areas of struggle and suffering. First, to take up our cross and follow is to suffer a lifelong battle against sin, and as it is a rejection of our earthly and fleshly desires. We also suffer in a war against Satan and the powers of darkness as we advance the kingdom of God. And finally, we suffer the reproach, hatred, and ridicule of the world by testifying in love that the deeds of the world are evil, by separating ourselves from the world both morally and spiritually. Notice I did not say physically, separated morally and spiritually, and by refusing to accept the world's standards and philosophies as our own. Jesus is telling us that in circumstances when our lives are threatened, if we acknowledge him, we pray that we are not in that situation, but there are some around this world that are. Denying him might save our lives, but eternal life will be lost. And conversely, discipleship may result in the loss of our physical lives, but that loss is insignificant when compared with gaining eternal life. Jesus used carrying a cross to illustrate the ultimate submission required of his followers. He's not against pleasure, nor is he saying that we should seek pain needlessly. He's talking about the heroic effort needed to follow him moment by moment, to do his will, even when the work is difficult and the future looks bleak. He asks for our submission, not self-hatred. He asks us only to lose our self-centered determination to be in charge. And don't we have a tendency to want to be in charge of our own lives? That brings us to this morning's other passage of Scripture. From Mark 10, verses 17 to 22, and we read about an encounter Jesus had with a man that some translations describe as a young man or a young ruler.
From the man's actions upon meeting Jesus, we know he was sincere and held Jesus in high regard because he fell on his knees before him and called him teacher. The man then asked Jesus the same question that mankind has been asking throughout the millennia. What must I do to inherit eternal life? After all, don't we all want to know with certainty the answer to that question? Jesus proceeds to give the man a list of things that he's supposed to do. Do you recognize them? Do not murder, do not cheat, honor thy father and mother, etc. Essentially, Christ is listing off the six commandments that prohibit wrong actions and attitudes towards others. And when he hears this, the man is pleased because he can proudly state that he had kept all of those laws since he was a boy. And Jesus recognized the man's earnestness and sincerity, and he felt genuine love for him, even though Christ knew the choice the man was about to make. You see, Jesus loves us all so much that he will give us tough advice. He won't hedge on the truth. You can imagine the pride, man's pride shaking and faltering when he heard Jesus say, "One thing you lack." Oh, here it comes. But the man is probably still hopeful that he is about to receive the key to eternal life. And Jesus looks at him and in verse 21 says, "Go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." Jesus' response was not meant to shame him by exposing his failure to understand the spiritual depths of the commandments, but was an expression of genuine love. You see, Jesus recognized that the young man's primary problem was his wealth, and Jesus' prescription was to get rid of it. There's no indication that Jesus' command to him was meant for all Christians, just to those who have the same spiritual problem. The man became sad and went away. But why? He was just offered eternal life. He was given the key to the kingdom. All he had to do was listen to what Jesus had to say. The scripture says, because he had great wealth, this became difficult. You see, while he was able to keep the other commandments without sacrificing too much, this sacrifice was more of a price than he was willing to pay. You see, money represented the man's pride of accomplishment and self-effort. And ironically, his attitude made him unable to obey the first commandment, which is to let nothing be more important than God. In the verses that follow, Jesus tells his disciples that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God, and that it's easier for a camel, the largest animal in all the holy lands, to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom. Now the disciples are thoroughly confused by all this. The religious leaders of the day believed and taught that wealth was a positive sign of God's approval, of God's special favor, and that poverty was a sign of faithlessness and God's displeasure. Flipping things upside down again, Jesus taught that not only was wealth not necessarily a sign of faith or a partiality or favor of God's, on God's part, it could actually be a barrier keeping people out of heaven. Jesus was trying to show them that the riches could be an obstacle to salvation and to discipleship, in that they gave the person a false sense of security and demanded time and attention that belonged to God alone. Since their physical needs are met, the wealthy often become self-reliant. And then when they feel empty, they can simply buy something new to dull the pain that was meant to drive them toward God. Lord, they are in no way spiritually or morally inferior. The disciples asked Jesus, well then, who can be saved? Jesus responded that with man, this is impossible. No, he did not say improbable. He did not say unlikely. He did not say it would be tough. He said it would be impossible. But not with God. With God, all things are possible. See, God does not save because of what we have done. He could care less about our resumes, our financial prowess, or our planning abilities. This man was thinking in terms of earning righteousness to merit eternal life, but Jesus thought that it was a gift to be received. Though the young man thought heaven was one payment away, Jesus was saying, what you want is more than what you can pay, and that is why you need a Savior, a Redeemer. The gift of eternal life or salvation cannot be earned by self-denial. It can't be earned by giving one's material goods away, but it's received by following Jesus. In the case of this young man, in giving his wealth away, it would have removed the obstacle that kept him from trusting Jesus. It wasn't the thing that was going to get him into heaven. It was removing the obstacle that allowed, that kept him from trusting Jesus. As Max Lucado described it, it wasn't the money that hindered the rich man, it was the self-sufficiency. It wasn't the possessions, it was the pomp. It wasn't the big bucks, it was the big head. The man came to Jesus wondering what he could do, and he left seeing what he could not do. If our focus is on amassing wealth and material possessions, then our spiritual lives get choked out, which can easily then lead into all kinds of temptations and harmful desires and even abandonment of our faith. Just look at what enormous wealth has done in the lives of many athletes, actors, musicians, politicians, and others. The destruction that appears in so many of their lives is frightening. But the pursuit of wealth in and of itself is not a problem unless it becomes our agenda. See, John D. Rockefeller, whose wealth in present-day dollars would nearly exceed that of Bill Gates, Mark Zuckerberg, Donald Trump, and Michael Bloomberg all rolled up together, was asked once how much was enough. And he said, just a little. You see, the goalpost is always moving, and one is never fully reached. And the more that is amassed, the more time, effort, and money is required to protect and maintain it. It's a never-ending cycle. And if the continued pursuit of wealth is not the agenda, maybe the agenda becomes what can be acquired with it, like drugs, sex, power, influence. A single-minded focus on amassing great wealth and material possessions is an indication that life is no longer being seen from the vantage point of eternity. You see, a selfish, greedy person no longer has his goal and fulfillment in God, but rather in himself and his wealth and possessions. Many people spend all of their time and energy seeking pleasure. Jesus said, however, that the world of pleasure centered on possessions, position, and or power is ultimately worthless. Whatever you have on earth is temporary, and it cannot
If you work hard at getting what you want, you might eventually have a pleasurable life. But in the end, you will most likely find it hollow and empty. Are you willing to make the pursuit of God more important than the selfish pursuit of pleasure? So what barriers are keeping you from turning your life over to Christ? We must remove all such barriers to serving Him fully. Every Christian must examine his or her own heart and desires. Am I a greedy person? Am I a selfish person? Do I yearn for abundance? Do I have a great desire for honor, prestige, power, and position that often comes with great wealth? If Jesus were to ask you, could you give up your house? Your car? Well, maybe some of us are. Your level of income? Your position on the ladder of promotion? Are those things your servants, or are they your masters? As Christians, the wealth and possessions that we may have must be viewed as God's, and that we are the stewards of what is His. See, God does not condemn wealth. God understands, and God has provided for many people. Quite frankly, even some of the poorest in this country are extremely wealthy compared to some of the poor in other countries. It's the pursuit of it and the focus on it that is the problem. We should be generous, ready to share, and be rich in good works. Wealth in and of itself is not the problem. The problem is when we value it over our relationship with God. We all have agendas in our lives. The question we have to ask ourselves is, are we pursuing a political agenda, a professional agenda, a personal agenda, any of those focusing on ourselves and on building ourselves up in money, power, or prestige? Or are we pursuing a kingdom agenda, focusing on God and building our relationship with Him, not growing His kingdom on earth? God is asking, are you following His agenda, the kingdom agenda? What is our answer? As we move to the part of the service where we are going to share in the sacrament of Holy Communion, I want to share something with you before we do. As you know, I moved into the parsonage just a couple of months ago, and while a lot has been unpacked, there are still some things that are getting out of boxes. And one of the things that I've come across, and I love books and I love history, and I came across a book that I had, The History of Hancock County, by D.B. Beardsley. And the copyright is 1881. He wrote it from Findlay, Ohio, and it was a Republic Printing Company out of Springfield. It's registered in the Library of Congress. A lot of information in 1881. And there's a section in here on Mount Corey. I thought you might be interested in it. See, this town that this church is located in was laid out in November of 1872. And it talks about how the lots were readily sold and quite a number of buildings were erected. And there's a large and convenient school building for the accommodation of the children of the district. And the Evangelical Association owns a church building. And the Methodist Protestant Church also have a fine frame building and a flourishing Sunday school. It goes on to talk about the village. Well, as you know, the Evangelical Association church building that he's referring to in this book from 1881 is the building you're sitting in today. And the Methodist Protestant Church frame building that he's talking about is our Bethel Family Life Center, just down the street. You see, why this is important. Remember last week we talked about traditions and rituals and things that we follow. And it's important that we don't put them higher than our relationship with God. Are they more important than the God we serve? But when they help us grow closer to God and join in community and in fellowship, they can be wonderful things. And so we are going to be participating in a ritual and a tradition, a sacrament, in a moment that has been experienced by people in this building for 170 years. And the people who have experienced that ritual and tradition in this building were following the tradition that Jesus set out 2,000 years ago. And the supper, the Seder dinner, the Passover meal that he was sharing with his disciples that night had been practiced as a tradition, a ritual in the Jewish faith for over 2,000 years before that. The point is that we have a long, rich history of the sacrament of Holy Communion. That many, many people have gone before us who experienced this sacrament that draws us closer to Christ and reminds us of the cost that was paid for each of us. And that great cloud of witnesses that we talked about last week during All Saints' Remembrance, they share in that communion with us. And it's our responsibility as we go forward to the generations that come behind us, make sure that they are aware of that tradition, that ritual, that sacrament, so that they too can enjoy and remember. As I mentioned, on the night before he was crucified, Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room to share the Seder meal of the Passover that had been their tradition of the Jewish people for thousands of years. And in the middle of the meal, he took the bread. He held it up and gave thanks to God, and he blessed it, and he broke it. And then he said something different than had been said before. He turned to his disciples and said, "Brothers, this is my body, broken for you. As often as you do this in remembrance of me." And after the meal had ended, he took the cup, and once again he held it up and he gave thanks to the Father.
blessed it. He said, "This is my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As oft as you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of remembrance. We thank you that this table is open to all. We thank you for the sacrifice that it represents, the price that was paid for us, that we deserved, but that you took upon your shoulders so that we could be much lighter than stuff. Lord, help us during this time be drawn closer to you. Help us remember the meaning of these elements. And as we take them in, let us take that as a part of us. Be thankful and share that gift with others. Amen. If this time you wish to take your communion elements out of your pew, you can peel back the top seal to reveal the wafer. And when you've done so, we will take that together. The body of Christ, broken for you. Revealing the fruit of the vine. Brothers and sisters, the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the rich heritage, not only of the people in this church building, but of all the saints over the last 2,000 years who shared the same meal together. We're thankful that we're able to join in that meal with them and with you. We just ask a special blessing on each of us here, that we can take this gift with us and share it with others. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning can be found on page 672. God be with us till we meet again. Verses 1 and 4.
Thank you.
And now until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you.